Ham Radio Now, episode 37. And Packet is back in TAPR. I never really left. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I want to apologize for sounding bad, probably looking worse, and I guarantee feeling worse. I'm getting over some flu. Maybe I can't even say I'm getting over it. Been going on for several days, and I'm not really feeling that much better. I've got an hour or two of something approaching productivity where I can sit up here in the editing chair, and then it's back to flat on my back. But there's a couple things I wanted to get done here, some episodes I wanted to get out. So I'm doing my best. I'm playing injured. And there were a couple of other things besides the TAPR programs I wanted to do this week that I just wasn't up to. So maybe we'll get to them next week. There's some interesting things going on out there in ham radio that I want to try to work into ham radio now. Putting a little now into ham radio now. There is one thing I want to point out right away. Back here, I've made some adjustments to the Ham Radio Now website. Let me see if I can bring that up here. I've changed the header, at least until Christmas, to stick in my iconic ham radio poem, A Ham's Night Before Christmas. If you haven't seen that, or you haven't seen it this year, you haven't seen it lately, stop by the hamradionow.tv website, and I think you'll enjoy that. I've upgraded it this year to high definition, since we're all high definition, and spread the word around on that if you know people that haven't seen that yet. It's, I think, the most popular thing I've ever put on the internet, with cumulative views between my YouTube site and ARV Insights and a version I made for the ARL. It's 70, 80,000 total views so far. So that's, you know, way above anything else that I've ever done. I'd love it if the average Ham Radio Now program were seen by 80,000 people. We're lucky to scrape 1,000. So stop by and take a look at that, hamradionow.tv. While you're there, of course, Arvin is there, and you can make a contribution if you feel so inclined to do that. So back at the Packet universe, this is our program for this evening, the 1 o'clock talk on Friday from the TAPR Digital Communications Conference. Brian Hoyer, K7UDR, is going to be talking about a hailing channel for packet radio, and he's splitting his time with John Hays, K7VE, who is going to talk about something called Net44. Now, a typical internet address is a series of numbers, quite a wide series of numbers, and the ham radio group has been allocated its own series that begins with 44. That's what Network44 is all about. If you've been in packet for a long time, you'll remember something like that. And Brian is going to talk about what it was and what it could be, to use this valuable resource. As far as the hailing channel is concerned, I don't pretend to be an expert in packet. But when I got started in packet in the mid to early 90s, one of the big problems was just exactly what John is going to talk about in this episode. Everybody wanted to be on the same frequency so that you could see all the traffic, and the frequency got too congested, and nobody wanted to be on that frequency because there was too much traffic. So that was 145.01 at the time. Today, well, we'll see what Brian has to say about that. Coming up in packet, we're going to see in the next episode, this fella from Finland. I can't pronounce his name, but I can tell you what Steve Bible said his nickname was, Jesus. Jesus is the guy that invented the APRS.fi website. Now, that may sound familiar to you, and if it doesn't, we'll take a quick look at it. It's a website that is hosted over in Finland that carries all a composite of all of the APRS traffic. So if anybody's made a transmission on APRS, you can see it there, as well as a bunch of other stuff. And it's probably the easiest, most interesting way to take a look at APRS without actually running APRS. So that's a fascinating thing to do. And then looking on down I can get control of this thing here. Here we go. At future episodes, Andrew Pavlin, K2DDO, is going to talk about what he calls yet another APRS client. And there have been some problems with finding good APRS clients. Every time I try to go look for a good APRS client, I haven't found a really good one. The best ones are old and clunky and don't work very well anymore, and everything else has got a lot of compromises. So this one looks like it's got some potential. And then Jesus comes back and talks more about the development of APRS.fi. So some interesting things coming up in the world of packet, and not all of it in 1,200 baud 2 meters. In fact, I interviewed Brian at Dayton earlier this year, and he and John are with an organization called NW Digital Radio, and they're coming out with an interesting new box, which he talks about in this episode. It's a UHF 70 centimeter data radio, a high speed data radio. It'll do up to 56 kilobits per second. It will run packet. It'll run some other interesting data modes like D-Star. And I think it's got the potential to sort of resurrect and advance the art of amateur radio packet. So we'll see. That's what this episode is all about. So let's go back down to Atlanta and the TAPR Digital Communications Conference and get started with the P, the packet, in TAPR.
So welcome back from launch. Our next topic is now a hailing channel for packet radio by Brian Hoyer, K7UDR. Take it away, Brian.
Thank you. Okay, so this morning we talked mostly about software-defined radio, and now in the afternoon we're going to swing over towards the other side of digital communications. I note that although TAPR has a great focus on software-defined radio, I think it still stands for the Tucson Amateur Packet Radio Group. So let's get right into it. Packet channels. When I talk about packet, a lot of folks say to me, oh, packet, that was fun in the 80s. Isn't it dead now? And I say, yeah, it's dead. Well, except for Winlink. People go, oh, yeah, Winlink. Email over VHF, UHF, that's still a good thing. And what about APRS? And well, APRS is a very active area. I belong to the TAPR APRS SIG, and they get a dozen messages a day. So there's a lot of activity there. So packet is far from dead. It just has changed forms. So when I got involved with packet, it was a few years ago. I live in the San Juan Islands in Washington, and that's kind of a remote place. So I got involved with the local MCOM folks, and they rolled out their new spiffy box. And they said, with this couple hundred dollar radio and this couple hundred dollar TNC and a laptop and some cables and some software, we can do 1,200 baud. And I said, wow, I'm totally underwhelmed. Seems like a lot of money and gear to not go very fast. But on the other hand, I was intrigued by it, so I thought packet's really interesting. So recently we had this task of putting up a digipeater to increase our coverage. And the first question somebody asked is, well, what channel should it be on? And I went and looked and I went, wow, there's actually a lot of area carved out for packet in the band plan. So up in our area, it's probably different where you are, but we've got 10, 20 kilohertz channels in the band plan that are specified as packet channels. And in the 440 band, we've got about twice that many. But the question is, how many do people use? Which brings up the channel paradox. So we go to put our digipeater up, and the only thing it makes sense to do is put it on the channel that everybody else is on, because that way you can talk to the most people. But of course, if you want to use it, you want to be on the channel that nobody else is on, because that way you get all the bandwidth. And so how do you solve that? Well, you create a hailing channel. You simply tell people that there's a channel on which you do hailing, and you pass your traffic someplace else. This is a brand new and novel idea that nobody else has done before. Oh, wait, everybody does this. So when you're on an HF net, when you say, I've got traffic for Seattle, they say, I'll take the Seattle traffic. And the net control says, go down 5 and handle your traffic. If you've ever been in a boater's net out in the water, there's always somebody chatting on 16, at which point some helpful individual will say, 16 is for hailing only. Please move your traffic to 68 or 69. And I don't see any trunked radio in the amateur space. Am I wrong about that? Is anybody doing trunked radio? In the amateur space? Okay, so there is a little bit of trunk radio coming in, but trunk radio basically says we have a pool of frequencies, we designate a control channel, and when you PTT, you go over the control channel, which assigns you an available channel from the pool, and your traffic's handled there. So the concept of a hailing channel for packet radio or any kind of radio has actually been around for a long time. So what would the protocol look like? This is just kind of a quick sample. So we all monitor the hailing frequency. That's great because we no longer have to scan through all the channels trying to find out where people are. And here's an important point. What I call resources, things like iGates and gateways and mountaintops and repeaters, they need to beacon to let us know where they are. Once we've identified the resources, if we have traffic to pass, it's an RTS, CTS kind of thing. And then we QSY to a clear channel. We're going to talk about what a clear channel is in a second. And then when we're done passing our traffic, we're going to return and announce the channel's clear. I'm also a pilot. We have any pilots here? Okay, so after you land, you acknowledge on the radio that you've cleared the active runway. So it's the same kind of thing as we want to know what channels are there, which creates an obligation on everyone's part to kind of keep handle of which channels are clear. So the second QSO goes to an available channel, and then when it returns, it goes to the unused list again. So all we have to do is agree on the hailing channel. Chuckles. What was that?
14439.
Why? What if we pick the APRS frequency as the hailing channel? Because as a wise gentleman just recently said, that's what it's there for. So I was expecting to get some pushback on this. Like, don't put it there because we don't want any more traffic on APRS. But I think you're right. That's what it's there for.
That's what APRS was designed for, is the single locating point to start.
And your name is? Hi, Bob. Well, the great thing about being Bob is that you're the father of APRS, so if you say it's good, then it's probably good. And like I said, I was expecting to get some pushback, but apparently that's not happening. So if we go through what APRS is all about, and Bob will correct me if I've got it wrong, it's the situational awareness channel. And resources are already beaconing on it. Ah, glasses. And the other thing about APRS is that they want to keep traffic short. You know, get on, say something, get off. So this type of technology is appropriate to that. I'm going to leave the last bullet off and come back to it. I want to talk a little bit more about the shortness of APRS messages. Well, one thing that we're doing in a radio space we're looking at is getting things going on 440 because we get higher bit rates at 9600, which gives us more available space. But as far as keeping traffic short goes, there's a lot of methodologies we have that allow us to keep the traffic very, very specific. So an RTS-CTS handshake is about as quick as you can do and do a two-way exchange. There's also been some push to say, well, how do we get email over APRS? And I'm not thrilled about that because it's inherently a different kind of thing. APRS is designed to have short messages and email, well, some of the emails that I get, they get quite lengthy. So the notion of saying, why don't we pass our connection-based email over the APRS channel, I think that's a mistake. I also note that lots of folks have both RMS gateways and iGates, and in fact, the software to do both at the same time exists. But the problem is the RMS gateways are on different frequencies than the iGates, and they have to be to avoid the traffic problem. But if we had them on a single channel, every location that was an iGate, which is a location that has a radio and an internet connection, could also be an RMS gateway. So the advantages, everyone's on the same channel. Better spectrum utilization. We've got 20 packet channels on 440 and three or four of them are active. And the reason it's only three or four is the same problem of you either have to get on a voice channel and coordinate at where you're gonna move to, but there's no automation of the process. So we have crowded channels and unused channels. Something else that's interesting is we also have the ability to take it one step further. And not only can we say, let's move our traffic off the hailing channel, but let's also look at channel bonding. So in the 440 space, there's also some 100 kilohertz channels. And channel bonding is interesting because you can do 9600 on each of 25K spectrums. But if you bond it into a 100K slice, you can get up to 56K. That's actually limited by the FCC. It's the symbol rate. You probably can do closer to 80 or 90 kilobits over a 100K channel with some of the newer protocols. So why hasn't it been done? Well, we need computer control radios. And what we have now with our conventional TNC methodology is the computer dumps the information into the TNC, which does the modulation and talks to a conventional analog radio, but there's no feedback from the radio. So we don't actually know about drop packets. We don't know about changing frequencies. That doesn't exist. Is Phil Karn still here? Hi, Phil. So I was playing with this, and I said, you know, this whole thing doesn't really work very well. And so I dug around in the literature, and I found Phil's 1980-something paper about the KISS protocol. And in the first paragraph, it says, the KISS protocol is a temporary measure designed to get us on the air until we have systems that speak HDLC. Yet all the systems on the air are still using the KISS protocol. Phil, thanks for doing it. Can we retire it someday, please? Well, maybe we can. What we need are frequency agile radios that have a fast RX-TX turnaround. So I looked around and I couldn't find any, so I made one. And I sat about with a couple of guys I ran into in the San Juans, one of who is a very good software programmer from the network space. And I met this guy over here, John Hays, at DCC in Vancouver 2 years ago. And on his slides, he did a big D-Star presentation. And he got down to the end and said, and something else I'd like someone to make is a radio that had Ethernet on one side and antenna on the other. And I said to John, I said, I'd like to build that radio. And so what we built was basically an 800 megahertz Linux server. Who's played with the Raspberry Pi? Okay, good. Half our radio looks very similar to a Raspberry Pi. It's a little more powerful. It's got a little different configuration suitable for what we want to accomplish. But it's that kind of platform. The other half of the radio is a 25-watt, 70-centimeter transceiver. And the reason I picked 70-centimeter is threefold. One, it's a much bigger band. Two, it's already carved up in 25 and 100K channels for digital, so it's very amenable to that. And three, first and foremost, I want to keep 2 meters clear for voice communications because it is the lowest common denominator. So in my vision, a station should be able to do voice and digital simultaneously from a location. So what protocol should we support? Well, there's two dominant ones deployed, AX25, which is a good one to start with, and also D-Star. So we decided to support both protocols because we're pretty much all things digital and protocol agnostic. I've had some requests to do the Moat Turbo stuff. It's not quite as free and open as one might at first think. There's some commercial things which make it not as accessible, but if somebody wants to put the effort into it, we'd look at that one too. So the radio is both a client and a server. If it's got an internet connection, then it's a server or a gateway or a digipeater or a BBS or whatever you want to call it. It could be a gateway, it could be an iGate, it could be a D-Star gateway. It's also a standalone radio. It's about the size of a brick. We've got one sitting prototype in the room next door. You can stop by and look at and get some more information on it. So how do you control a network radio? Do we have any Mac users? Okay, great. It's going to be a Mac-only interface. No, wait, that's not a good idea. I've heard about Qt, and there's some toolkits out. So the multi-platform radio, if I have to project forward and say, where are my next users? A lot of them are on iPhones and pads. So what we did was we built a browser-based interface using WebSockets and some fallback stuff so that you can control the radio. So basically everything above the red line is the head on the radio, and all the functions you need for email and everything else are just menu driven off of that. This is just the channel page where you could select channels. So that runs on any machine that has a browser, and it has fallback modes to get all the way back to. Did anyone realize that Microsoft just said they're going to have support for Windows XP until 2020? And that 74% of the desktop marketplace in the US is still running XP? Boy, if that's not an indictment of Vista 7, 8 that nobody adopted, I don't know what is. But don't let me be a Mac bigot, because I'm a relatively recent Mac bigot. And so if you have a browser on Windows or Linux or Mac or your phone or your pad, we have an interface to deal with that. So what I'd like to do is, you know, when I said let's pick a frequency, I got a chuckle. It's like, oh, people are going to agree on something. The great thing about ham radio is we don't have to all agree on anything. But we do need a few folks in a geographic area to agree on something. And if they could do that, then we could try this out. And I think it's going to have some merits, and I think it'll have some problems. But the great thing about amateur radio, and the reason a lot of you are here, is because we want to play with it. Other things. The question came up, thanks to the guy from Flex Radio who did an excellent intro of why radio should be on the network and stuff like that. The one other question I will address is the bulk of the software that we run came from the open source community. So all of our stuff will be an open source project. And we're going to ship it in two versions. The MCOM version that you buy, and you set it down, it just works. But if you ask us for the keys, you can have the keys and you can put whatever you want on it. And the only proviso there is when you brick it, go to the forum and say, I bricked my radio. Is anybody else out there able to help me? Because obviously we can't support the fact that we recommended you use this $12 USB accessory and you found one for $9 and said, why doesn't my $9 one work? And my answer is, I don't know. Go on the forum and see if anybody else bought the $9 one. So that's my pitch, is we're going to have these radios available later this year, be shipping them in the first quarter, and I hope we get some interest from some people that want to give it a try. Thank you.
Any quick questions? He said later this year.
So the current schedule, we just posted an update on our website. We had to go through a second prototype cycle because I wasn't happy with the RF performance, and I want to first and foremost make a good radio. So the second prototype cycle is happening now. We should have beta units in the field later this year, and as soon as the beta is successful, at that point, I'll accept orders for delivery in Q1. It's about a 6 to 8 week lead time for getting everything built. Any other questions?
Next question. Are you planning to do a duplex radio front end as an alternative?
When we launched this at Hamvention back in May, I went with a couple things on my agenda. One, is this a good idea or not? Do people really want it? And the answer to that is, yeah, people like it. The second thing is, so what should the next product be? And two things came out of that time at Hamvention. One, a duplex radio. And the second one was a multi-band radio, probably on 440 and 220, because having a dual-band radio gives you some advantages. The problem with full duplex in the same band is now you have to have a duplexer, and duplexers are not frequency agile. So I lose that ability. But having a dual bander on 220 and 440, I could have a full duplex radio that was also frequency agile within the band. So those two things, making a full duplex version just means putting two radio cards bundled with the same computer card. That's pretty straightforward. And the second thing is changing the band on one of those two cards. So those are probably the first two add-on things we'll do next year, is a duplex version and a dual band version. Any other questions? If you want to talk more about the radio, I'll be around in the demo room after the show. Thank you all.
Great. Thank you very much, Brian.
So next up, let's give a welcome here to John Hays, K7 Victor Echo. He was going to give us an update on the AmperNet, the 44 net. Thank you, John.
Okay. Thank you very much. You're going to see a whole bunch of slides go past here really quick. I'm kind of, you know, reuse is a good thing. So that's what Brian was talking about there for a minute. Okay, so how many people here are familiar with Net44 or AmperNet? Okay. So what it is with some foresight, a gentleman in California, when the internet was young, and I guess I was too, got us an allocation specifically for amateur radio. And back then, networks were classified A, B, and C. And an A had 16 million addresses. And so we have 16 million addresses out there that are kind of sitting dormant. There's a little utilization of them, but it's not being utilized in a wide application. And we've had these for, Brian, are you in the room? The other Brian. I think Brian stepped out. We've had them for 25, 30 years. And they're kind of cool. You know, Bedell and Phil and I, back in the day, when we were younger too, played with a lot of this stuff. Phil and I met back in Massachusetts when I was in the Air Force, and Bedell was in Colorado part of the time I was in Utah. And we were playing with all this stuff. I was sending TCP IP over 1200 baud packet through 7 NetROM nodes to California and getting my 20 bits per minute effective data rate. But it was fun, and I learned a lot. And Bedell and I both worked for HP. I went on, he continued a career there. A lot of my career, I had a lot more in-depth understanding of network protocols because I watched them go by at 1,200 bits per second. It's kind of hard to watch, you know, a sonnet ring and figure out the protocol. But at 1,200 baud, you can watch it paint on your screen and so on. So it's served me well, and we'd like to pass that on to future generations. So basic ground rules, as I said, is it must be used for ham radio. Otherwise, they'll want it back because it's valuable. So the network kind of started with IP over AX25 at 1,200 bits per second with collisions and all kinds of things, which took it down. A lot of manual processes were developed. I am the address coordinator for Western Washington. At various times, I've been the address coordinator in other areas as I've moved around a bit. You want an IP address, you send me an email. I talk to a robot. The robot adds it to a list. It comes out probably within the next day. if you're talking to other stations, you know, it's fun to talk to yourself, but it's more fun if you're talking to other stations. You need to have routing tables to tell you how to get your bits to someone else's place. That's all kind of manually maintained right now. There are files that get copied around between different gateways on the network. It's fairly limited. We've got little pockets of semi-activity here and there. And the way they talk to each other is they take the IP packets for Net44 and they wrap them in the IP packets from their service provider and ship it based on these manually maintained routing tables to similar gateways around the world. And if you want to talk to the internet, then it has to go to the University of California, San Diego through a throttled pipe to get out to the internet. And so in today's world, that seems just slightly limiting. And it looks something like this. So here we have three different LANs that could be anywhere in the world. And they, because of these tables, can talk with each other if they're up to date and maintained. And they can each independently talk to the main gateway to get to and from the internet. And that's exciting. I'm kind of like Brian. Sometimes I get, you know, I have this real question. You know, we come up with these great ideas in ham radio, and then we figure out the hardest way to do it. So back then, you know, you took the retired 286 that had the noisy disk drive in it, and some good programs were written, NOS by Phil, and later JNOS and some others, and you put that on them, and that hooked up to your TNC and your old Gonset set, and you kind of sort of made it work. And then you had this kind of obtuse way of declaring routing tables and so on that get manually copied over. And today, I was going to bring a visual aid, but I forgot to grab it. You can buy a very capable router that can do everything that several hundred watt creaky old 486 that you upgraded to 15 years ago in a little tiny package like that, and draws like 1 watt, you know, kind of thing. So why don't we use some of the advancement of the last 30 years to build a real network? So there's this vision out there, and it's been coming from a few different places. We've got this address space. We may as well connect it all together and be able to talk to each other. And there's actually quite a number of applications out on the internet that are ham radio specific, that use IP as their transport. The Flex Radio, the UDR, are other examples of that where you might want to talk to them over the internet. One of the nice things is, if we're using this 44 net address space, you can tell your Flex Radio, if there are commands coming in and it's not from network 44, ignore them. There are several applications like that. And we want to make it really easy to set up a new gateway. So using some of this off-the-shelf technology, we can have basically pre-configured routers that you can buy for under $100 with everything with it and drop it in and have a gateway. Now, when you want to jump off to RF, you're going to need something like your TNC and old FM radio, or something like the UDR or some other more modern type of equipment that you'll hook onto that with Ethernet. So Brian Cantor, who is the custodian of that address space and is here at the conference, pulled together a small committee a few months ago. We kept it small because we wanted to get something done. And what will be published shortly on the amper.org website is the new acceptable use policy for AmperNet. And what comes out of it is that we're going to be able to delegate that address space to more places, so it doesn't all have to go through Southern California anymore. And a lot of automated processes are either built or in the process of being built to get rid of these manual processes of sending things around. So, how many people here are network engineers? Most of you know what BGP is. So, what you'll be able to do is, if you have the experience and the ability and the access to some point of presence on the internet where you could offer up a BGP, you'll actually be able to get an agreement with the Amateur Radio Digital Communications Corporation to get your own segment of the network and advertise it to the broader internet. So what this means now is, instead of having a tiny straw to get data back and forth to the internet, we've got this giant sieve. And it'll be a, you know, 1,000 points of light, if we want to go back a couple of decades, that can now talk to the larger internet. But as far as address space is concerned, if it's from Net44 or going to Net44, you know you're going in and out of the amateur radio domain. Whoops. So, so there are applications that make sense to use this. You know, some of it's just traditional, you know, regional use of IP address space. So, someone that is a second tier ISP who can put things into BGP tables and just offer the service to hams internally might get a, what we call a sitter 16 allocation, and we won't do anything less than 24 because then the internet police will come beat up on us. But it will allow us to start segmenting this address space out, and you can have the regional ones. You can also have application specific. So let's say you've got IRLP nodes, or you've got D-Star gateways, or you've got Winlink RMS gateways, or a high-speed multimedia network for your Aries group. What you might want to do is get an allocation for that service. And you can VPN in the individual units. One of the problems we had in D-Star for a long time, and still do to some extent, is a lot of them are on consumer-grade broadband, and you end up with, they'll only give you one IP address, and it's dynamic, and if they're a bad ISP, they change it every 30 seconds. And it's hard to keep things routed when you're in that situation. However, if you're on a VPN, the modern VPN protocols can handle the public IP address changing pretty rapidly, as long as it knows the other end, and it can keep the sessions going to now what are public IP addresses on Net44. So if you run an RMS gateway and you say that it is at this domain address, which maps to this IP address, it doesn't matter what the public IP address you got for your ISP is, you can always address it at this Net44 address. So it gives you a lot of capability there. And again, it's not real security, but at least you have an idea it's coming from or going to a ham radio resource if it's not on Net44. So capable hams can apply for a revocable subnet delegation. What that means is if you play by the rules and you don't sell it off to your employer or something like that, you'll be authorized to have this subnet. And if you break the rules, the agreement is that it gets pulled. So as long as you're playing by the rules, you can get the address space up to the smallest block that will come out of those 16 million is 256, which is a sitter of 24. You must have a non-political willingness to tunnel to smaller subnets at no cost. So let's say you're in Atlanta and, you know, this is a population center, so you might request a full slash 16, and then you've got some outlying areas that need some addresses, and you're going to VPN those in to your router. Well, you can't charge for it, and you can't be political about it. Okay, we don't need those kinds of wars. And you have to be able to demonstrate that you can set up and maintain it. So with subdelegation, then you've got a situation where you're the BGP going to the internet, and then you've got these smaller networks that are coming through you to go out, and of course they can talk to each other just using the 44 IP address, because if it's local, it'll go through your router and back if it's another 44 that's out over the internet. And we will allow dual homing, so in certain situations it may make sense for one to be in more than one location. This is an interesting project. A guy's working up in our neighborhood where he wants to do 150 megabit per second loop of microwave stations covering the whole Puget Sound basis. We don't know if that's going to happen, but it might make sense in that case for him to have a relatively large allocation of addresses here. I'm indicating maybe 32,000 for individual home units to be able to get into it. It's all on microwave, so mobile's not going to be real popular there. You need to be able to support a choice of VPN tunnels, not necessarily everyone that's out there. But again, going back to my earlier bullet point about easy to deploy, there are certain VPNs that it's real trivial to put them into a little router that costs $39 and have them be part of this network. And so basically, we also would probably go with a situation where you have more use of DHCP and other dynamic allocations to get the IP addresses and domain names out to where it made sense, especially for mobile use. I know in my address space that I am the coordinator for, we've got stations that have got IP addresses on five different LANs because they might pass through them or they might see them. And there's really no sense to do that. They should get their IP address from the LAN they're on, and then the routing works and it's all cool and stuff like that. And of course, with radios like the UDR, then 56K mobile is probably more reasonable. So you might have a situation where you're driving through a metropolitan area and you're switching from LAN to LAN and node to node, and if you have frequency agility and a GPS so you know where you are and a few other things, it becomes more like a cell system where you're moving in and out of different LANs and your IP address may change, but your domain name will stay the same, and if people need to call you, they can do it. Of course, going out, it's not a big deal. The DNS name can travel with you. Talked about the virtual networks. And so any questions you might have on that?
Yeah, since you're going to be sending BGP advertisements to the network, do you have an autonomous system number, or are you going to require each group to get their own ASNs?
I will leave that to people that are more expert in that to answer that question, but it might be through the ASN of the ISP that's advertising your BGP.
Okay, normally you need an AS in order to advertise routes. Have you talked with any carriers about being able to accept advertisements? A lot of carriers won't accept BGP ads.
Right. Understand. Jeremy can probably answer those questions if people have more specifics.
V6, where is that going to come in?
Well, one of the great things about V6 is V4 maps inside of it.
True.
We own 16 million V4 addresses. We probably aren't going to use them up real quick. But there's no reason you couldn't have as part of a larger network, you know, some V6 space as well.
Well, since V6, everybody in the room would probably have 500 of them.
Yeah. And that's another thing that comes out of this, though, is so let's say that in your ham shack at home you put in 3 UDR 56Ks and a flex radio and some of the applications running on them, and you got a bunch of other things, want to use the same well-known ports to talk to them, like a web port or something like that. Well, if you go to your ISP, he's going to give you one IP address. He might block port 80 for you to run a website on it. But if we VPN, say, 8 addresses to your house that are publicly routable, now you've got a situation where you have static routable IP addresses available to you for multiple applications inside of your shack. I personally have a Class C network because I was around when you could still get them. And I have those tunneled into my house, and I have several applications and servers and stuff like that. So there's a lot of utility that can come out of that.
Yeah, I can probably answer to the technical question of BGP. There is no technical reason why we couldn't do both, allowing people to use their own AS or using a central AS that the corporation would acquire. It might cost some money, of course, to do that too. But there are plenty of people like myself and some that I know who are network engineers who have access to their own AS. So we can do both.
Yep.
And VPNs and whatever, if we like.
Yeah. I used to be a little more knowledgeable about that, but I got the lumbotomy and I work in management now.
Well, at least you're not a marketer.
So my question is about if we've got these tunnelable and routable AmperNet that may be going over a gateway through to HSMM or to something that's actually using amateur frequencies, how do we deal with the issues of content filtering?
Mm-hmm.
And how do we deal with the issues of third-party traffic? My big problem is somebody sits down at their computer or somebody's wife grabs their laptop and they're on the HSMM net instead of on their local internet connection and orders a pizza from Papa John's. Mm-hmm. Now, am I, as the control op of the gateway, responsible? How do you solve those problems?
Well, I mean, it's the same issue that we had. And of course, the FCC told us 20 years ago that you can order a pizza over amateur radio. So that particular case is okay. So here's the way I kind of vision it. So at your house, you're probably NATed out for your LAN in your house out to the internet, and the computers there can get to anything. And I'm aware of the time, and we'll wrap this up. But the routers could say only accept inbound connections from other 44.net addresses. And there's a reasonable argument to be made at that point that you're trying to limit the traffic to amateurs only. Outbound connect to anything, right? The content is really the responsibility of the person who puts it on RF. So the endpoints have to kind of make that decision. We're out of time. I'll be around. I'll be kind of, you know, the two red shirts you heard from Twiddly D, and now you've heard from Twiddly Dumb. And we'll be glad to answer some more questions offline.
Thank you. And that's all the time we have. Thank you very much, John.